everyone. This is Pastor Ken. Good to see you guys today. I am sitting down, which isn't something I normally do for Sunday morning, but I hurt my back this week. I don't even know what I did to it, but it is killing me. So I'm just going to sit down today if that is okay with you. Hey, today we're looking at Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, and I love this chapter. There is so much in this chapter, and this chapter is a great reminder to us because it shows God's love for us. Over and over again, it shows how much God loves his children. In Luke chapter 15, there's three parables. And remember parables. Parables are an earthly story that have a heavenly meaning. So they're a story that anyone could understand, but the meaning of the story is something biblical. It's heavenly. It's got a deeper meaning than you just would see on the surface. And so look with me at Luke chapter 15, the three parables that are in this chapter, and see if you can figure out the theme that kind of runs between them. The first one says this, verse number 3, Jesus told this parable. What man of you having 100 sheep, if he lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays his hand on it, on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. The next parable, we'll come back. There's a verse that we're skipping, but we'll come back to that in a moment. Verse number 8, or what woman, having 10 silver coins, silver's pretty valuable, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she's found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors and says, rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost. So in one story, there's a sheep that's lost, 1 out of 100. In one story, there's a coin that's lost, 1 out of 10. And look at the third story. The third story is a story you probably know, you've probably heard before. It's the story of the prodigal son. Listen to me as I read this story. And he said, that's Jesus still, there was a man who had 2 sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that's coming to me. And he divided his property between them. So there's a guy, he's an older guy, and he's got 2 sons. And in that time, kind of like this time, when the father dies, there's an inheritance. Anything that the father owned would go to his children. At that time, the 2 sons. Well, one of the sons, the younger son, is a jerk. He's so mean. He's so rude. He goes to his dad and he pretty much says, Dad, I wish you were dead. Like, I wish you were dead. But because you're not dead, could we just pretend you're dead and you give me all the money that you would give me when you die? Now, can you imagine saying that to your parents? Dad, like, I kind of wish you were dead so I could just have your money because I don't really care about you. I just care about the money that you have. That's terrible. That's awful. But that's what the dad says. Or that's what the son says to the dad. Horrible, horrible, horrible. Well, the dad gives him all the money that he would get when he would die. And look at what the son does with the money. It says, verse 13, not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. So the son takes all the money, all the stuff, he leaves, he abandons his dad, abandons his other brother, leaves and he goes far away, and he just spends the money and spends the money and spends the money. Now, we don't know exactly how much money his dad gave him, but you figure it was a lot of money. It was a good amount. But he's buying this and he's buying that, and pretty soon, all that money that he'd been given is gone. It's gone and it's not coming back. Verse 14, and when he had spent everything, all of it, a severe famine arose in that country and he began to be in need. So he spends all the money while times get hard in that country and he doesn't have anything. It's all gone. He wasted it all. So what does he do? Verse 15. So he went out and hired himself to one of the citizens of the country who sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. Now, pigs were gross to the Jewish people. They were considered unclean. They were a type of animal that the Jewish people weren't allowed to eat, would not have wanted to spend time around. So man, he has sunk so low, he's in with the pigs. And look what he says, verse 16. As he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, no one gave him anything. So he is so poor. He's so hungry. He has no money for food. He's looking down at what the pigs are eating and going, oh man, I wish I could eat that. Man, what the pigs are eating, that looks so good. I can pretty much guarantee none of you have seen what a pig's eating and gone like, oh man, that looks good. You go to eat at your favorite restaurant and you're like, could I have what the pigs eat? Okay, no. The pigs eat what's left over, the gross, the yuck, the filth, after everybody else ate. In fact, where I went to college, it was in Wisconsin, and there was a pig farm near where I went to college. And one of the guys who worked at the college in the dining hall, he was trying to be nice and kind to the pig farmer. So what he would do is every day when the people were done, they would scrape off what was left of their food, like half-eaten food, into a big bucket. And every night that guy who was being nice to the pig farmer would take the bucket over to the pig farmer, and the pig farmer would use that to feed his pigs. And man, I saw what was in that bucket. I wouldn't want to eat it. You wouldn't want to eat it. It was disgusting. But man, that's exactly what this guy, this prodigal son, has left. He's like, oh man, that looks so good. I'm so hungry. That looks so good. So look what happens, verse 17. When he came to himself, okay, when he like realizes, oh, I've been a fool, oh man, I messed up, oh man, I had it so good. When he comes to himself, he said this, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I will perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. So this son, who had it so good and is just realizing how good he had it, listen to what he does. He's like, man, even the guys who work for my dad have it better than this. So I can go back to my dad, and he might not treat me as a son anymore, but maybe he'll just hire me as a servant, and I can work for my dad like the servants do. And it would be a lot better than looking at what the pigs have and thinking that would be so good. Verse 20. So he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am not worthy to be called your son. But the father said to him, you lousy son, I hate your stinking, rotten, lousy guts. I can't. No, that's not what it says. Look, here's the thing. His father sees him and his father runs to him. And this guy's like, oh, I'm a mess. I'm so sorry. I was a jerk. His dad isn't mad at him. His dad doesn't hate his guts. His dad doesn't like hold it back. His dad's like, my son, what's up, my son? Oh man, he's giving him a hug. He's giving him kisses. Look at that. It says his son, his father embraced him and kissed him. And his father said to the servants, quickly, bring the best robe and put it on him and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet and bring the fattened calf and kill it and let us eat and celebrate. For my son was dead and he's alive again. And they began to celebrate. Listen, all three of those stories have the same point. When the sheep, the one sheep out of 99, the dude's got 99 other sheep, so who cares what happens to the one? No, the good shepherd goes out and finds that sheep and brings it back in and takes care of it and rejoices. Listen, that coin that was lost, the lady doesn't just go, oh, it was one coin, I have nine others. No, the lady searches and searches and searches and searches, and when she finds that coin, she tells her neighbors, dude, I found my coin, I'm so happy. That one son. The father doesn't go, oh, forget him. He was a jerk. He was mean to me. He took my money. He didn't care about me. He wished I was dead. No, the father's looking for his son. And when the father sees his son coming back, he runs out there and hugs him and embraces him and kisses him. Listen, that's how much God loves us. That's how much he cares about us. Man, we sin against God every day, and God isn't up in heaven going, man, that Pastor Ken, what a loser. Man, I'm so sorry I saved him. No, God's going, man, I love that. I love Ken. And man, I'm sad that he sins, but I'm so glad when he's like, oh God, I'm sorry, and does what is right. Listen, God loves you. God cares about you. And some days you might mess up. And some days you might really make a mess of things. We all do. And some days you might even feel like a failure. But God loves you. And he cares for you. And just like the shepherd with the one sheep and the lady with the one coin and the father with the one son, he loves you and he's so glad when you, who even though you're a sinner, when you come back to him and go, ah, Lord, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. So maybe today, listen, I don't know. Maybe you and your parents had a fight this morning and you were disrespectful. Maybe you've been disobedient to your mom or dad. Maybe you've been unkind to a brother or sister. Whatever it is, take some time this morning and just say, God, that was wrong. I'm sorry. And God forgives you. And God loves you. And God brings you back in, just like the shepherd and the lady and the father. We serve a good God. Let's pray. God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you that even though we mess up, man, we mess up, we sin and we fail, you still love us. You still love us. And when we sin and fail again, you still love us. Thank you for that, God. Thank you for that in my own life. I need that, Lord. I thank you for that in the lives of these kids who are watching. Lord, may we know your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, thanks for joining us again, guys. I hope I saw you at church today or whenever you're watching this. We hope to have you if you're at another church. Man, I hope you can be there as quick as you can. And just know that we love you. But more importantly, God loves you. Have a great day.